So this talk will be a special. This will be simultaneously a talk that's part of the QuICS, this Frontiers workshop, but also the JQI weekly seminar. It'll be given by Seth Lloyd. So Seth got his PhD from Rockefeller University with Heinz Pagels, and then he did a, maybe it'll take it out. No, I won't take it out. And then he did a postdoc at Caltech with Murray Gell-Mann, and then another postdoc at Los Alamos. Since 1994, he was he's been on the faculty in mechanical engineering at MIT. He's a fellow of APS and did lots of seminal work in actually very different areas of quantum information. And we're fortunate to have him give this a talk. Please, Seth.
Thank you. So it's great to be back here. I gave a different talk on a similar topic at the kickoff meeting about a year and 4 months ago, whenever it was. I've been really impressed over the last few years at what an amazing community has been built up at JQI and in the DC area in general. But I spent a lot of time, you know, graduate students or undergraduates come to me and say, I'm interested in quantum information. Where should I go to graduate school? And I used to, you know, 5 years ago, I was saying things, oh, well, you should consider MIT and Caltech and Waterloo and great places in Europe, et cetera. Now, the second place I mention after MIT, because I was forced to mention MIT first because of my contract, is JQI and the University of Maryland. I say, look, you know, this is an amazing place with a great diversity, fantastic theorists, fantastic experiment going on, and in the greater Washington area, there's a huge amount of work going on in quantum information processing, both theoretical and experimental. And so I tell the students, you know, you'd be crazy not to consider going to a University of Maryland and JQI. So congratulations on doing so well. Or maybe you should tell me I shouldn't do this. Maybe I'm wrong. So I only regret, I normally get talks on the blackboard. The organizers forced me to do PowerPoint. This is my idea of a PowerPoint slide. As we know, PowerPoint is Satan. So yes, designed for business people to convince other business people of things that are not true. hence, very appropriate for scientific talks. I'm going to talk about today about universal deep quantum learning. So there's a lot of words in this title. It all sounds incredibly amazing and deep and stuff like that. Most of what I say will not be very deep at all. Indeed, as we'll see, classical deep learning is not deep in the sense of, you know, deep thought or anything like that. but what I'd like to ask, the main question I'm trying to ask in these talks, and the talk will be mostly about open questions, can we build a large-scale quantum device, say, using integrated superconducting circuits or using integrated photonics? I'll talk about that in a bit. Can we build a large-scale quantum information processing device, say with a few thousand quantum bits, capable of doing a few million operations in a coherent fashion, that will solve hard problems of pattern recognition, data analysis, and learning? That's a question I'd like to ask here. Now, the talk will be mostly on the theory of both classical deep learning. In fact, I'll spend half of the talk just talking about my rather rudimentary understanding of how classical deep learning takes place. And then I'd like to raise open questions of what is quantumly learnable. So, okay, so here are the kinds of questions I want to ask. So what is deep learning? This is actually, I can tell you, give you an answer to this that passes muster with real deep learning people, classical deep learning. So what kind of patterns can be learned by classical computers? Here, nobody actually really knows this. We know that many kinds of patterns can be used by classical computers. As you know, whenever you get on Google and they try to sell you some piece of junk that's related to an obscure moment of your past, right? They can find all kinds of patterns in what you've been doing on the internet over the last 20 years. And what kinds of patterns can be learned by a quantum computer? And the main question is, are there patterns in data that can be learned, let's say, efficiently by a quantum computer, but not by a classical computer. So that's the main question that I'd like to ask. We actually have a bunch of examples of such patterns. So let me just say in general what I mean by machine learning. So let me start off with what I mean by, this is the problem. See, the problem is if you're at mercy of your PowerPoint slides, if you're writing on the board, you can just think it up and write it down. But here you have to follow what these darn things say. Crazy. So the general machine learning problem is to find, given some data, which could be a humongous data set, like, you know, Google's data set of all the websites on the internet ordered by page rank, or all the videos on YouTube, find patterns in the data. That's a general machine learning problem. And on rather generally, machine learning tasks fall into two possibilities. One is supervised learnings. So you're giving a training set, which is pairs of data points together with classifier labels. It associates classifier label C to each data point D. For example, for looking at handwritten numbers, the data could be some handwritten number 5, and the classifier could be, hey, it's 5, okay? So you're given a lot of such instances. Find an algorithm that assigns a new data point D to the correct class C. This is called supervised learning. It's all over the place. So you're told how to classify the data. And unsupervised learning, which is actually in some sense more interesting, but more general and vague, is given data D, find classes C that naturally partition the data. So there have been some famous examples recently where people used humongous deep classical learning networks that involve, you know, 50,000 computers and millions of hours of computer time. And they fed it a gigantic number of YouTube videos. And at the end, this deep learning network was able to look at a YouTube video and say, there are people playing soccer in a field, right? Turns out to be a very hard problem. Actually, much more interesting is when it fails, you know, the mistakes it makes. You can always learn more from the mistakes, people's mistakes, than when they're right. Maybe not in my case, I don't know. Since the latter happens so rarely. in this case, the computer looks at the data and tries to classify it into different classes, making up the classes as it goes along. So this is a harder problem, and the key word here is the naturally. What does it mean to naturally partition the data? So that's kind of the general notion, abstract notion of machine learning. And actually what happened? I had another slide here. Okay, yes, okay. So we actually do have a bunch of examples of quantum machine learning algorithms that do a lot better than their classical versions. So let me just list these examples. This actually is essentially in one slide that the whole content of the talk that I gave a year ago in May, or March, whenever it was. And there's reason to hope that we can have quantum algorithms that will do better at machine learning, certain machine learning tasks, than their classical counterparts. So given some data X, the way that these algorithms that do significantly better than the classical ones work is you store the data in a big random access memory, but it's a quantum random access memory, so you can query the terms in quantum superposition. This was being used in Robin Coet's kind of amazing talk, but I thought that was really an amazing result. This was being used, for instance, to have the entries of your matrix A, you can query to quantum superposition. And then rather generically, under conditions which were mostly really laid out by Grover and Rudolph quite a while ago, you can take this vector stored, classical information stored in random access memory, and you can construct a quantum state, which is a normalized quantum state, which gives you a normalized quantum state, which is the same vector. Now here's the things that we know over the last few years. we've been able to figure out that you can do better than classical computer algorithms. So one is what Scott calls forelation. I can't remember, is it with two R's or F-O-U-R, Scott?
Two R's.
Two R's, okay. Well, you can see I hedge my bets by having both an R and a U on top of it. So forelation is you compare a vector with the Fourier transform version of this vector. Now, Scott has some very nice papers that shows that this seems to be very hard to do by classical sampling. It appears, you know, if the vector is of size n, it appears to take order n to actually n samples to the memory in order to figure out if a vector is correlated with the Fourier transform version of that other vector. So this is very nice, and you should talk to Scott about it to make sure that you get the real right answer. It's really a very simple example of something that seems to be very hard classically. But quantum mechanically, of course, is a straightforward matter. If you can construct these vectors, you can construct S, X, you take its quantum Fourier transform, or even more simply, its Hadamard transform on each of the bits, so the binary quantum Fourier transform, compare it to the vector Y, and then ask, do they have a high overlap? So this is something that is exponentially faster quantum mechanically than classically. Another nice example of something you can do exponentially faster quantum mechanically than classically is this work with Nathan Weaver. He kind of included me on the paper. Because I did part of the paper. You have a cloud of data points, and you say, well, there's a line or a curve that goes through these points, and you want to construct the minimum two norm line that goes through it, you know, basically fitting a line to the data. This you can have, these may be very high dimensional vectors. You may have a very large number of them, but you can actually construct a simple representation of this line quantum mechanically very rapidly on a quantum computer. A similar kind of thing, actually note that all the pictures look the same here. This is actually because, not entirely because I lack imagination and can't draw, though my children tell me I can't. There's a version of quantum machine learning where you're given two clouds of data points and you want to draw the optimum separating hyperplane or polynomial surface. This is called a support vector machine. So Patrick Rebentrost, Masood Masani, and I showed that you can construct this optimal separating hyperplane, and then actually given a new point, classify it over to this side or to the other side. You can do that exponentially faster on a quantum computer than classically. We have a principal component analysis, which is one of the very most common forms of analyzing large amounts of data. You construct the covariance matrix for the data, which is just the sum over x sub j transpose. And then you just want to find its principal components, its largest, its eigenvectors corresponding to its largest eigenvalues. This is something you can do exponentially faster. I think last time I mentioned that we have an algorithm that will actually calculate topological invariance. Again, you take the same pattern. These are all clouds of dots, because all data points look like clouds of dots. And then you try to extract some geometric, or in this case, topological feature of it, counting the number of holes, voids, that is to say, calculating the Betti numbers of this data set. This also is exponentially faster quantum mechanically than classically. Of course, many of these statements have caveats that it means exponentially faster than the best existing classical algorithm. So, and finally, I'll just mention a project, a couple of papers that Patrick Rebentrost and I are working on right now. Well, there are many. One of the main uses of big data is to do financial stuff. So in fact, it turns out that many of these algorithms are susceptible to quantization. By the way, there is something called quantum finance, which is not quantum finance, is this method which recognizes that the Black-Scholes equation for option pricing is essentially the Schrodinger equation in imaginary time, and then uses methods from path integral methods swiped from quantum mechanics to try to evaluate what the price of an option for a bond or a stock should be. This is not that. We are actually doing things like portfolio optimization, though I'm not exactly sure if anyone in this room would be willing to let us invest their portfolio using a quantum computer. I certainly wouldn't, and even if we would be building it. And then we also have a very nice, a swanky option pricing algorithm to price very, very complicated options. And why would we do this? Well, I felt that, you know, in 2008, when the global economy was being brought down to a large part by unemployed theoretical high energy physicists in Wall Street, capable of making very complicated models of what's going to happen, because, you know, if you actually really want to make an extremely complicated, mathematically rigorous model based squarely on data that will give you some predictions with very precise notions of error to predict the future prices of stocks and options, you should definitely hire somebody with a PhD in string theory. We felt that in quantum information, we kind of got left out of this, so we wanted to build an algorithm that would take down not merely, you know, 30% of the global economy, but the entire global economy at once. We feel that it should be possible with a quantum computer to do this. Yes?
A quick question about the quantum finance.
Does
that involve taking superpositions of different positions, or is it simply an analysis of classical portfolios?
Right. It's just an analysis of classical problems that happen to involve very large amounts of data and trying to construct portfolios that analyze, you know, the all possible portfolios that you could have and extract a good one out of there. Yeah, but of course, it's a very interesting question that you raise. Suppose that, you know, one were to use quantum computers and quantum communication channels to construct a quantum market where you can submit superpositions of bids on things. You know, what would happen then, I dread to think.
Question about the topological invariance.
Yeah.
Are you using something like persistent homology to do that?
Yeah, that's right. So these are quantum algorithms for performing persistent homology. It turns out that, though on the face of it, it doesn't seem as if topological invariants are that susceptible to being attacked by quantum computers, persistent homology, which I won't describe it in great length, but persistent homology takes discrete data points and tries to extract topological features, that it works operating using algebraic topology, which involves actually finding eigenvectors and eigenvalues and inverting very large matrices over gigantic sets of simplices. So in this case, the boundary map, or the combinatorial Laplacian. I knew I couldn't get it past you. Somebody would ask, so. Anyway, I'm not going to talk more about that here, although it is a fun algorithm. So let's actually look at classical deep learning algorithms. So when a few years ago, Patrick, my postdoc, who, by the way, is the driving force between all of these algorithms, he came and said, hey, we should look at things like deep learning. I said, wow, what's deep learning? Sounds incredibly great. It sounds like, you know, computers will soon learn things about life and love and truth and happiness and, you know, tell us what to do. But sadly, it is not that way. Deep learning is learning using deep neural networks, which have lots of layers. Deep refers to the number of layers in the neural networks. Deep learning is all the rage these days, you know. Any graduate student with a PhD in deep learning can easily get a six-figure salary. Fancy people can get seven-figure salaries, et cetera. because these are the kinds of learning systems that places like Google use to try to sell us more junk by probing our past, right? So money can be made. And here is it, the idea of deep learning goes back to the 1980s. When people started making neural networks, and I'm going to describe to you a particular method called a Boltzmann machine, which was developed by people like Jeff Hinton and John Hopfield worked on this as well, back in the 80s. So the interesting thing is that most of these methods in deep learning, the kind of basic ideas, were produced back in the late 70s, mid 80s, and they kind of worked pretty well for a while, and then they crapped out. They weren't doing much better. Now at that time, and I remember this because I remember John Hopfield saying this to me when I was a postdoc at Caltech, he said, well, it's true they're not working very well now, but if we just had a huge amount more data and much, much, much bigger computers, it would work, I swear, it would work. And well, you know, now we have 10 to the 9th times as much data, and we have computers at 10 to the 6th times faster and more powerful, and by God, it's working. It's incredible, they were right. So let me describe to you how a Boltzmann machine works. This is classical, but I'm going to describe it in quantum mechanical terms. So the idea is you have this network. You have a visible layer in which you put the data. Each thing could either be a 0 or a 1. There are zeros or ones at each of these nodes. And these lines represent interactions between the nodes. For instance, a node could be a 0 or 1, and I can have a little sigma z term that penalizes 0 and enhances 1. Or I could have ferromagnetic or anti-ferromagnetic couplings between these nodes. So my overall Hamiltonian is just actually an Ising model. And these A's and the B's are called weights, and they're supposed to be tunable. And the idea is to tune these weights through this network so that if you put a, if you energetically bias the visible layer to gain a piece of data, then the low energy states of the system will automatically make these classifier nodes say, hey, it's number 5. Right? That's the idea. Okay? This, by the way, is what's called a stacked restricted Boltzmann machine, because they're stacked because there's layers stacked on top of each other. Restricted because there's no connections in each layer, but there are connections between each node at one layer and all the nodes at the layer below and the layer above. That's what a stacked restricted Boltzmann machine. These things work very well once you make them big enough. So what's going on here? So the first thing to note about this stacked restricted Boltzmann machine, this is, by the way, a fun thing to verify on your own. If you were a class, I'd give it as a homework problem right now. But I normally I come down to Washington and then people tell me what to do rather than otherwise, so I'm not in the habit here. why does this actually good at recognizing things? It's a simple observation that this network is computationally universal. So if I go back to this network, I can arrange these interactions so that the ground state or the low energy states of this system enforce a flow through logic circuit that takes bits here and requires the bits at the next level to be simple logical functions of the bits at the previous level. For example, it's easy. You just have an anti-ferromagnetic between something at this level, an anti-ferromagnetic interaction, and this forces the thing at the next level to be not X. So if this is X, the next thing at the next level is not X. Similarly, if you have a ferromagnetic interaction between two things at the next level, why, this is a copy operation. So I say, at this level I have X, now I copy and make two copies of X at this level. And it is a fun exercise to show that by tweaking the individual sigma z terms and the ferromagnetic and anti-ferromagnetic interactions between four things like this, at three layers of this stacked restricted Boltzmann machine, that you can make this output right here be either x and y, x or y, x and y, x nor y, or anything you like. And since, copy, not, and, or, and are universal, then I can actually program this device to, by adjusting the weights, you can enforce the low energy states to implement arbitrary flow through logic circuits from the data to the classifier level. So you can imagine the data as being the input, and then you have the classifier as a logical function of the data, and vice versa, because this thing is completely symmetric. So I can also enforce arbitrary flow through logic circuits from the classifier level down to the data. That is to say, the Boltzmann machine can enforce any computable relationship between the classifier level, the classes, and the data. And this is why, at bottom, why the thing actually works. It's, it's computationally universal, classically computationally universal. Now, of course, that doesn't mean that it's easy to find how to do this. The whole trick is to see if you can't actually find sets of weights that actually cause this machine to give you the answers you want. And here's why it's called a Boltzmann machine. This is all, for machine learning people, this is all blast from the past stuff, probably expressed slightly inaccurately by me. So your goal is to tune the weights, the individual sigma z terms, and the interactions, so that the probabilities you get for the classifier level on the data, which are given by a Boltzmann distribution. So you assume that you look at the thing at some finite temperature. You say, aha, I'm going to sum over all the possible states of the hidden level. I have some Boltzmann-Gibbs factor that weights each of the data. This is why it's called a Boltzmann machine. And we want to set this up so that the probabilities for the classifier and data pairs, C and D, match the actual frequency of C and D in the data. And throughout this talk, I'm going to call actual probabilities Q of C and D. So that's, broadly speaking, the goal. We're trying to implement and learn a physical system whose Boltzmann distribution matches the probabilities of the data. And actually, more precisely, what one ends up doing is in these papers. And by the way, the early papers on this are very fun to read because it's kind of like math papers of the 19th century. You know, you can read them and actually understand them. It's amazing. Whereas actually, if you go and start reading the papers that were written the last few years, it's not so clear that you can understand them. At least, not so clear that I can understand them. And so, you actually, what you try to do is you adjust these weights to minimize the relative energy between the actual data distribution and your current guess of the data distribution. And for those, if I actually plug in this formula for P sub D, you find that this is actually the minimization of the effective free energy of your Boltzmann machine. So it's a very nice physics-y thing, and that's not very surprising because, you know, John Hopfield was a physicist, my God. He just went to do neural nets just for the heck of it. All right? So are there questions about this? This is just a review of Boltzmann machine stuff, but it's useful for trying to understand what's going on. Okay, so and how does this learning take place? So actually there's a lot of very fancy things that go into this Gibbs sampling. If you sample this Boltzmann-Gibbs distribution, you do something called contrastive divergence, and I won't describe it because I actually forget exactly how it works and I get it wrong. You have this notion of backpropagation, which was developed by Hinton, again, back in the 80s. Backpropagation is a really nice idea. The idea is you start with your data here. You start adjusting weights at this level to try to get higher, you know, get your probability distribution to match the data more. Then you go to the next level. And then actually you go in the other direction. So you start generating guessed data sequences going in this direction. So first you try to train your constraints to make information flow like this through this circuit, and then back the other direction. That's my understanding of it. There's more technical ways of doing it. But basically the main way that people do it nowadays, I understand from my informants who go to these large machine learning meetings, is that they to heck with all this fancy pants stuff. Let's just do stochastic gradient descent on the space of weights. We got these humongous computers anyway. You know, they can explore all this. Let them just, you know, try to find sets of weights that, you know, drive you in the right direction. And this method, complemented with a wide variety of sneaky tricks, works very well. And the reason seems to be, well, I'll talk about the reason on the next page. The reason seems to be is that even though this gradient descent is often trying to find a very, very, very shallow gradient in a very, very high dimensional space, there are enough solutions there that eventually you'll get to something that works pretty well. I don't think anybody really understands this. But I just want to describe something very briefly that I found. This also was invented by Hinton, called the wake-sleep, and I call it the wake-sleep-dream method. Our colleague Hartmut Nevin at Google calls this the wake-sleep-hallucinate method for reasons which actually is more accurate, as you'll see in just a second. So this is actually based on what the brain actually does, okay? So what happens in the brain? The brain actually, the human brain and other brains, you have a cortex, a neocortex, which is kind of where the sort of, you know, fully recursive Turing universal information processing goes on. And then you have got this little nugget called the hippocampus. The formation of long-term memories and the consolidation of long-term memories takes place in the following way. And by the way, nobody understands just what's going on here, but what I'm telling you is stuff that they can actually tell from doing brain imaging, looking at chemicals of the brain, etc. So during the day, you have inputs, sensory inputs coming in. They get processed through the cortex. And then they get moved through the cortex. This is just information flow. And then they go into the hippocampus, and a feedback loop that is being constantly being adjusted by external inputs gets set up between the hippocampus and the neocortex, and the weights, that is to say, the synaptic weights in the brain, get adjusted as a part of this feedback loop within here, modulated by this inputs from the outside world. Well, that's not so strange. I mean, this is like sounds perfectly reasonable. So the interesting thing is that why isn't that enough? That should be fine. That should be enough. That's how kind of ordinary machine learning things kind of work. So what happens at night is you don't have any sensory inputs, but this feedback loop between the neocortex and the hippocampus just keeps going on. It's going strong all night long. And in fact, the stuff that's actually generated that gets up into your conscious perception by this stuff that's going on all night long are, in fact, dreams. There's, in very deep sleep, this feedback loop is actually just goes on very similarly to the way it goes on during the day, but without these inputs. During rapid eye movement sleep, the feedback loop between the hippocampus and the neocortex gets disrupted by larger amounts of the neurotransmitter cortisol. And this is when you have these really weird dreams, because what happens is the feedback loop gets disrupted, and so all of a sudden stuff that you were associating with one thing gets associated with something else. You know, you enter a door of your apartment, my apartment in Boston, I end up in my old apartment in Tokyo. It just messes everything up, and it's totally crazy. And I bet everybody in this room has had this, you know, these kinds of dreams, and yet they're completely natural. We don't freak out. It's like, hey, that's what's going on. And so by the way, this presumably has a function that, you know, it's very important to be able to associate similar memories with other memories, and so it's important to establish connections that connect these to each other. The other thing that, by the way, that goes on during sleep is that 90% of the synapses that were formed during the day get eliminated. This is a kind of consolidation of, you know, turning all this, you know, very rich sensory data into memories and stories that we tell ourselves, but to take a lot less algorithmic and computational requirements to make happen, because synapses are energetically costly. Anyway, it's kind of cool. So what happens in these wake-sleep dream cycles is you do the same thing. First, you turn your neural network with inputs. Then you set it up so it actually just has feedback in between the layers. Then you actually set it up so it starts dreaming or producing its hallucinations of what the data should be like. And now you create a new data set and you retrain it with its own dreams and hallucinations. And this works much better than just having it learn from the real world. This is pretty amazing, actually. So, who here knew about this before, by the way? Are there any machine learning people here? Oh, good, I can say whatever I want. And people are like, I was being cautious up until now.
Okay.
Why does deep learning work? I think the real answer is nobody really knows, okay? People try out lots of different things, which makes sense. You've got a vast quantity of computing power, and it works very well. In fact, it works so well that there's this kind of, apparently some kind of civil war going on in machine learning. The kind of old school people who came, you know, work with Marvin Minsky and folks like that say, we have to understand what's going on in the brain and how the brain actually processes information, and then we will be able to construct machines that can learn it. And the deep learning people say, we don't know what the brain is doing, we don't care, but we do better than you do. Nah, 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 nah. I'm just summarizing the whole argument right there. Plays out in a whole variety of ways. So my take on this, and I promised you nothing deep except the depth of the networks, is probably something that's going on like this. And it's actually quite related to how human beings and groups of human beings learn. Probably something that's going on is like this. That the problems that can be solved by deep learning are ones that can be divided up into logical subtasks. You know, the different parts of the problem, you know. You paint a house, you have to mix the paint, you have to clean the brushes, you have to get a ladder. You know, each of these can be done by another part of the circuit. And here I said different physical regions, but of course that's not really, doesn't have to be different physical regions. It can just be parts of the circuit that are logically disconnected from each other and that can learn some little piece of this problem on its own. That, of course, is not enough because you actually have to have feedback. You have this feedback from the gradient descent. And so if you do better on a subtask, And this has a detectable effect on the overall performance, even if you're doing really badly at first. Then this will cause these different regions devoted to these subtasks to move in the right direction, to get better at what they're doing. And finally, because these tasks, you have to coordinate the subtasks in order to make the whole thing work better. Along the way, doing better at coordinating subtasks has some detectable effect on the overall performance. So not all problems are like this at all. I mean, you know, the hard versions of KSAT problems and things like that don't have this feature. But there are a lot of problems that are like this, like visualizing problems. There are people playing soccer in a field. There's people, there's a soccer ball, there's a field, right? They're kicking it with their feet and not hitting it with their hands. You know, so conceptually, these problems may very well be divided up into these different subtasks which can be put together. I'm not saying that that's how they actually put them together, but you know, this is probably how it works. So in this case, even if the gradients are small, if you have lots of data, lots of layers, and lots of time, this works pretty well. Okay? So, enough about classical machine learning. Actually, are there any questions about classical machine learning before? Yeah.
So, how do you connect this idea of logical subtasks and different physical regions to the actual Boltzmann machine architecture? Because you have this idea of layers, and information propagates upward, but it doesn't propagate sideways.
Yeah, I think that the answer really has to be this feature that I mentioned, that the reason this works well in this architecture, and by the way, when people started, they started out, the original Boltzmann machines were fully connected, and they didn't do anything. They were really bad. So my guess is that this layer structure with things propagating up and down is exactly the feature you need to program in a flow-through logical relations so time or goes either this way or that way. It can go both because you're programming it into the ground state. I think that's probably what's going on, but I don't know. I mean, I'm speaking from a position of great ignorance about the classical stuff, and I'll continue to be ignorant about the quantum stuff here. Okay, so let's go on to deep quantum learning. So there are a couple of versions that one could do here. So here's deep quantum learning one. So we're going to use these classical Ising Boltzmann machines. So the relationships between the data and the classifiers is going to be classical, but we're going to replace these various weight learning things, such as stochastic gradient descent. We could replace it with Grover search, and there's a very nice paper from the Microsoft group with Krista Stove and Nathan Weber, and I forget the other third person on the paper. Or you could replace it with quantum annealing, so you make the weights themselves variables in your D-wave quantum annealer, and then the thing that's getting adjusted by your task is these weights, and these can be adjusted by quantum annealing. So in these cases, the deep network is still classical, but the weight discovery process is quantum mechanical. Now, we know that there are things that seem to, I maybe know is too strong a word, we know that there are things that are more easily discoverable by Grover search, and we suspect that there may be things that are more easily discoverable by quantum annealing. I think I've hedged my bets enough in that statement, because you might be able to find things by quantum tunneling that you can't necessarily find by stochastic gradient descent, which is essentially a classical annealing process. And so it might very well be that even with just these kinds of Boltzmann machines, these classical Boltzmann machines, the weight discovery process could be made quantum mechanical, and then you could find stuff that you couldn't find otherwise. I just bring this up because there's stuff written about it, and this is a perfectly reasonable use of quantum mechanics for this problem. And this paper shows that you can indeed get some kind of significant speed up in this process of finding weights. I'm working with D-Wave right now. I've made this architecture that allows the weights to be adjusted via quantum annealing. We'll just try it out and see what happens. So, I don't know whether you can do a lot better with this, but maybe you can. So, what I'd really like to talk about, and now is the actual topic of this of this talk, admittedly, it's coming two-thirds of the way through, but that's not a problem. Because I think it was very important to actually describe what's going on in the classical versions of this. What I'd like to do, really, and now I'm just going to raise, the rest of this is really going to be raised as a question, as a big question. And I will supply answers to some little pieces of this, kind of like I'm like a few little nodes in this Boltzmann machine trying to perform some of the tasks better. Okay? So, remember the feature of the classical Boltzmann machine, which I and I think a bunch of other people would guess makes it powerful, is it's got this feature that it can perform computation. It's computationally universal. You can program universal classical logic circuits into the Boltzmann machine and have any logical relations between the classifier nodes and the data nodes. What would be really nice and would be to do the same thing quantum mechanical. So we want to have a network of quantum devices that is capable of universal quantum computing, not just universal classical computing. And we'd also like, as in the previous slide, to adjust weights and learn the quantum, the circuit quantum mechanically, such as using Grover and quantum annealing. But it's this first point that I would like to address. So why might this be a good idea? I'm sorry, why might be good? I immediately said, I'm in Washington, I could beg for money on the basis of this idea. But apart from that reason, this is, why could this be a good idea? We have already seen, way back at the beginning of this, that there are quite a few very common machine learning algorithms where if you go in there and you do program your quantum computer in the correct way, they can actually recognize all kinds of straightforward, simple, and useful features of the data in a time that's exponentially faster than the classical versions. They run in poly log n, whereas the classical versions of these all run in poly n, polynomial in the size of the data set. These all run polynomial in the logarithm of the size of the data set. Maybe if we actually construct a device, such as a deep learning network, which has built into it the capacity for universal quantum computing, maybe it could learn not only some of these algorithms for, you know, data fitting of various kinds, but maybe it could find new ones that we don't know about. That is, maybe it could find, effectively be finding new quantum algorithms for finding and analyzing patterns. We reward it when it does well, we punish it when it does poorly, and maybe it would find these new algorithms for us. Okay, does this make sense? This is the goal. People are looking at me in a way where they're looking at me intently, but they're not asleep, many of them. Okay, that's good. So, now what do you need to do this? So, and now I'm gonna get a little technical, and this actually is technical in a way that's good for people in this room, because this is technical in the sense of how do you build such a device? And what's the theory behind it? So, it turns out that if you add, in addition to the Ising couplings in these Boltzmann models, if you add tunable Heisenberg or hopping terms, for instance, terms of this form that allows a qubit, a one, to hop from point J to point I, or from point I to point J, then these networks are now universal for quantum computing. They become universal by tuning the weights, by adding these terms, tuning these weights and the Ising weights. I can now construct networks that can perform universal quantum computing in a Hamiltonian fashion. So this is Hamiltonian quantum computation. We can do it both dynamically, and we can also do it in a ground state, which we could find adiabatically in principle. Let me just say a few words about this, the history of Hamiltonian quantum computing. So what is Hamiltonian quantum computing? Hamiltonian quantum computing was invented by Feynman back in 1985. The existing models of quantum computation at the time were kind of time-dependent, pulse-based models of quantum computing, where you say, oh, we have a time-dependent unitary transformation. And Feynman said, oh, I want to have a time-independent Hamiltonian that enacts this entire computation. And he gave a very sneaky trick. He had joined a clock to the system, and the clock had terms where, in the Hamiltonian, that would advance the clock and then perform the corresponding logic gate for the clock advancing, say, from point 6 to point 7. And it's a very simple and beautiful model. And then he showed that you could make the thing computationally universal with a time-independent Hamiltonian. This is the kind of thing we want to aim for here, right? Because we are adjusting the weights of the terms in our system. This is what we want to adjust. We have a Hamiltonian. Our goal is to either construct this Hamiltonian so it can either compute dynamically in time, or it can compute in some kind of, you know, way where as we adjust the weights, the lowest energy states of the system actually implement the computation. Because it was pointed out, this was that the Hamiltonian computer actually does its computation in the ground state. Actually, I think I have I think maybe I was the first person to point this out in 1992 in a paper in PRL called Quantum Computing and Uncomputability, where I pointed out that the Hamiltonian and the Feynman model contains the entire computation in quantum superposition, and the question of whether the computation halts or not tells you whether you have a gap between the ground state and the first excited state. If the computation halts, there's a gap. If the computation doesn't halt, there's no gap. Toby Cubitt just wrote a very, very long and elegant paper about this. My PRL is rather short and maybe not elegant. But so and then, of course, very famously, Kataev used this ground state version of Hamiltonian quantum computing to formulate the whole theory of QMA completeness. And then a lot of people came up with ways of trying to make this work physically. The original Feynman Hamiltonian has not two local, but four local interactions in it. And people use perturbative gadgets of various sorts to try to get them to the point where they could get two local interactions. I know that I'm speaking the language for many people in the community here. And maybe not for others. You know, these are perturbative gadgets are ways of going to higher order in perturbation theory to enforce the terms you need in something like the Feynman Hamiltonian to make it compute. The problem with this, and again, I'm actually giving you the most quantum information-y part of this just by standing up here and talking about this. The problem with actually implementing a physical system using, say, something like, you know, a large-scale quantum integrated circuit like D-Wave device, but adding these pairwise interactions, is that perturbative gadgets don't work for actually building really real devices. Because the problem is that the perturbative gadgets, the actual terms you end up getting in the Hamiltonian from perturbation theory, are very, 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 very teeny and will be swamped by noise and messed up by experimental imperfections. So there's a very nice paper by Daniel Nagai, who's here, showing how you actually construct, do Hamiltonian quantum computing without perturbative gadgets with two local interactions. And Barbiter Hall, actually we conceived this at the first, we talked about this, started talking about this at the first meeting a year and 4 months ago, whenever it was. And then over the last year and a half or so, we've come up with a way which is specifically designed to use two local interactions on systems like superconducting systems. That allows you to do Hamiltonian quantum computing. So this is my very long-winded way of saying that this is possible. You could build something like this. You could build something like this using kind of, you know, the ability to lithograph large-scale superconducting circuits of the kind that D-Wave is building independently of what you might think of D-Wave from a sociological perspective. One thing they do is make large-scale superconducting circuits. If you supplement the icing-like couplings on something like the D-Wave system with Hopping terms, Heisenberg terms, or pretty much anything you like that allows you to do something quantum mechanical, and that these are tunable as well, then you can construct circuits that are capable of universal quantum computing. And this strikes me as a potentially quite fruitful path to go down, certainly from the theoretical side, because theory is cheap, talk is cheap, and maybe thought is cheap sometimes too. But even also from the experimental side, because the kinds of interactions like this that one can have, they're readily available in existing superconducting systems. It'd be worth giving this shot and see what happens. Okay, how does this work? I just have to say something a little bit about how this works. I will try very hard not to go over. This is very super cool how this works. This is based on, in 1990, so Feynman gave this In 1985, 86, he showed how you do this Hamiltonian quantum computing with a single clock. In 1987, Norm Margolis from MIT showed how you can do this without having a global clock. And the idea is that you have a bunch of particles. Each particle, its position along a lattice, is its own clock. And particles can only advance while holding hands with the particle next to them. This is what's called an asynchronous cellular automaton. Norm Margolis, by the way, he was the person who made the famous first computationally reversible universal cellular automaton, the famous billiard ball model of computation. So he came by this honestly. So the idea is that these qubits are on particles. They advance through the computation holding hands. And the idea is that you have this string, which you can say this qubit, they're holding hands with together, they're holding hands, they're holding hands, they're holding hands. So along this particular string, which tells you the position of these particles, the state of the qubits is the state of the qubits on this space-like surface. It's what it should be if the computation has evolved from its initial state up to performing these states, these performing all the logical operations from down here up until this point. Things are being done in parallel. This string of now, so this is a kind of a notion of now in the computation. And Margolis said, oh, look, we can set it up. So we set it up with a string, and then the string will propagate through this computation, and when it gets to the end, it will perform the computation. The neat thing about this is if you do the computation in the ground state, so you set it up so that your computational Hamiltonian from this Margolis, or what Barbara Terhal calls the space-time model of computing, you set it up so that you're in the ground state of this Hamiltonian, what you get is a state which is a uniform superposition over all the possible strings, if you like, notions of now, or space-like surfaces, together with the proper state of the quantum system on that space-like surface. And this I claim, now allows you to understand something very basic in quantum gravity, because this is actually, if you're familiar with quantum gravity, more or less, to some degree, right, exactly. Not many people, right? So that's okay. So one of the basic equations of quantum gravity is called the Wheeler-DeWitt equation. It says H psi equals zero, where psi is the state of the matter fields and the gravitational field through all of space and time. What the heck does that mean? This is really pathetic. It says that nothing happens. Something is terribly wrong. But the way to understand it is that, in fact, the solution to the Wheeler-DeWitt equation is a superposition of all possible space-like surfaces that could foliate the space-time correlated with the state of the quantum fields on each of these. And by the way, when back in 1993 or 92, when I was writing this paper about the Feynman Hamiltonian's ground state, I ran this by John Wheeler, who came to Los Alamos. I said, hey, look, here's the Feynman Hamiltonian. Here's its ground state. It's got, you know, time t, state of the computer psi t, its uniform superposition. He said, it's just like the Wheeler-DeWitt equation. So, I mean, Wheeler said a lot of stuff, so don't think you should necessarily believe it, but hey. Anyway, so at least he claimed that it was the same. Okay, sorry, that's just an aside. So let me finish up here. I'm almost done here. So let's actually ask, what would such a universal quantum Boltzmann machine do for us? So given our classical data, which you know are these pairs of, let's use the supervised case where we know the classifier is associated with a piece of data, and frequencies or probabilities, Q, of this C and D, we want to train the weights W of our Hamiltonian H. And remember, our Hamiltonian is now computationally universal, so it can encode arbitrary quantum computations in its low energy state. We want to encode it so that the Boltzmann distribution, the thermal state of this Hamiltonian, in the limit the beta gets large, this would just be, of course, the ground state sector of this Hamiltonian, approximates the statistics of the classical data. So that is to say, I said this before, I'll say it again, the low energy sector of H generates and classifies the patterns in the data. So can we do this? Well, we actually know from the slide that I put on forward that if I go in and I say, oh, I'm going to program a particular very specific kind of quantum computation into this network, that in KP they can do things. They can, you know, they can forelate. It's always struck me as a slightly risque kind of thing to do, but I'm seems pretty clean. So forelation. You can do forelation. So we know that there are sets of weights that allow us to do forelation, that allow us to do data fitting, that allows us to do support vector machines, that allows us to do principal component analysis, that allows us to do fine topological features. But we know that those weights exist, but can we find them? Can we find them? You know? So, for instance, can we learn a quantum Fourier transform? So suppose we're kind of here, let's say we're given these in the form of quantum states, we're given C, D pairs, this is C, this is D, where D, the data, is the quantum Fourier transform of the inputs. So we're given a whole bunch of these things, we are given the promise that that one is a quantum Fourier transform of the other, and now we try to train our universal quantum Boltzmann machine to approximate quantum Fourier transform. Can you do this? I don't know. Okay. One thing that you can do, and Patrick and I at least have a sketch of a proof for this, and you'll once I state it, you'll say, well, why do you need a sketch of that? It's so obvious. One thing you could do is if instead of the quantum Fourier transform, you're just doing Hadamard transformations on each of the inputs, which is kind of the discrete Fourier transform, well, then you're going to do very well in learning that. And this actually, because, you know, you just say, oh, you know, I just did Hadamard on that input, Hadamard on that one, Hadamard on input. I just have to monkey around with these things in here until they're Hadamards and see if it works. And that's going to work because actually you get feedback to say, oh, I got the first bit right, I got the second qubit right, I got the third qubit right. There's no even talking between them. So this is, in some sense, almost trivial. However, it does train this neural network, this quantum neural network or quantum Boltzmann machine to do a task that Scott has shown seems to be really hard to do classically. So at least we have a almost trivial example that says we could train them to do this. Let me close here is an example. This is actually, again, since Scott is here, I'm taking his name in vain right and left. here is something that would be even really quite amazing, and this is another kind of device. So here's the picture of boson sampling, which is supposed to be hard. How does boson sampling work? I have a linear optic array. It's a tunable linear optic array. The weights are the settings of the beam splitters and the phase shifters. I pop in a particular sequence of no photon, noton, photon, no photon, no photon, 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 no photon, photon, no photon. So I pop a bunch of single photons into the input arms of this interferometric array, and then I measure the classical statistics for photons coming the output part. And Scott and his colleagues have shown that this, under very reasonable assumptions, that this is classically hard. That is, there does not seem to be, despite the fact that this is a linear optical circuit that on its own couldn't compute its way out of a paper bag, right? You need to have some kind of feedback, as is Knilva, Lafon, Milburn, to make it compute. It can't compute its way out of a paper bag, yet nonetheless, it can generate probability distributions that apparently cannot be generated except by some humongous classical quantum computer. Okay? So we have this strong evidence that something like this is powerful at generating statistics, classical statistics that are very hard to generate classically. So let's turn the problem on the other end. Let's start feeding the classical statistics into this side. And now let's try to adjust these weights to see if we can't get a one out of here, one out of there, one out of there, et cetera. Actually, if you give the quantum state here, if you give the full quantum state, you can probably do this. If we just feed the classical statistics and we say, can we actually try to learn what these weights are? That is, can we know that such devices can do things that, or you know, modulo things that Scott will tell you about in detail, we know that such devices can generate statistics that can not be generated classically in an efficient fashion. Can they recognize them? I don't know. Maybe they can. Maybe they can't. Anyway, because it's actually hard to show it one way or another, Dirk Englund and his group were planning an experiment just to try it out and see. Because we can do this. You can build these large optical arrays. I know I'm out of time, so let me conclude. Okay, so Here's an even more ambitious thing. Can a quantum deep learner learn how to factor? So our data, this is an unsupervised task. Our data is given a whole bunch of numbers. Our data is a whole bunch of numbers which happen to be the product of big prime numbers. Will it find P and Q? Actually, you know what? I really doubt it. So, I mean, but it's not, it's conceivable. I mean, actually, if you look at these classical machine learners, they can actually learn quite complicated programming tasks. This is pretty tough, though. So in general, and here's actually maybe the $64,000 question, so $64,000 doesn't buy what it used to, particularly with overhead. But can deep quantum learning, so we have evidence that deep quantum learning can reveal patterns that cannot be revealed classically. But can it reveal useful patterns in classical data that classical computers can't? Can it look at, YouTube videos and say there are people playing soccer in a field? Well, I'm not sure if that's useful, but can it look at my entire history on the internet and then try to sell me stuff that I don't need? Now that's useful, right? So, let me close there. Thank you very much.
So most classical machine learning algorithms have some notion of regularization of the weights to keep them from blowing up and becoming too large or some other such thing.
Yeah.
So how would we implement that in a quantum Boltzmann machine?
Yeah, so if the weights themselves are actually variables in the machine itself, then they'll only be able to take on some discrete and bounded set of values. But what you say, of course, is a problem, right? That if it turns out that the gradient that I'm going down wants some weight to, is heading for a solution where it needs this weight to blow up and get much larger than the actual range of values it has, then that won't work. So I think that one thing that we've learned in designing the quantum versions of these algorithms is that you should just shamelessly steal all the classical sneaky tricks that are out there and try to implement them and make them work. So I'm sure that some regularization methods would help us in this regard.
The unsupervised learning, maybe it's just a dumb question. Everything you're doing is you're playing with weights and trying to optimize the result. It seems like unsupervised learning, you often don't know what the result is.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So how does that?
Yeah, it's a vaguer thing. What you try to do is you try to say you have this classifier level.
I can even just say it in terms of what these things are trying to do.
So you have the same kind of picture of what's happening. Let me just look at this picture. So in supervised learning, you give the thing pairs with data here. You fix these energetically to be a piece of data, and you fix this to be the classifier. And then you try to adjust these weights to make this a low energy state, okay? With unsupervised learning, what you would say, you could have a very big layer here. You only have a couple of classifier bits. And you try to reward it for having, for deciding relatively unambiguously for a particular data which of these classifier bits fires up. And if you do that, then this device will try to classify this into, however many different states the classifier level has. And it will, if you reward it for doing so. And actually, these things do a very good job with this, right? I mean, you can give them very complicated systems and they can figure out that there's something called a car that's driving through this picture. And even though you never told it what a car is.
So you don't need to define the categories.
Yeah, it will define the categories itself. I mean, it's a squishier thing than the supervised learning. I share your discomfort at some level, but by God, it works.
So Seth, you pose this set of questions, like can a quantum learning algorithm learn the Fourier transform? Can it learn, a factoring algorithm, right? But for each of these questions, what's going to be relevant is sort of what is the class of possible functionalities that it could have been, right? I mean, like, if you give it enough hints that, you know, you want it to learn factoring, then sure, it's going to learn factoring, right? So, do you have any idea, like, what is a concept class of, you know, of functionalities that would include factoring where you would want to be able to learn anything within that class?
Yeah, that's a really good question. That's a great question. So, if the idea is that you're just kind of, you know, you're just trying to, you're setting up some class of quantum circuits, and you want to see what it can learn. So, I wouldn't be surprised, okay, if I just say something like this, it ought to be able to learn just to do a Hadamard on each line and not pay attention to the lines next to it. I think that's really reasonable. It might even be able to learn, if you look at the circuits that do the first few bits, the higher order qubits of the quantum Fourier transform, it's an eensy-weensy circuit that only acts on a small number of qubits. And so, you know, if these, you know, this set of qubits over here might very well be able to do the, like, controlled rotations and little tweaks that make up the quantum Fourier transform. That might happen. But as you say, if you want to, like, you know, learn something like Shor's algorithm, you'll need some hints. And let me actually take advantage of your question to pose another question. So, you know, if you look at quantum computation, there are only a small number of subroutines that we use again and again and again. We use Fourier transforms, we use space estimation. That's about it. So a very interesting class of circuits would be, suppose we just are given boxes and we say, hey, this box does a quantum Fourier transform. You know, this box does phase estimation. This box does a quantum walk, okay? And there's some knobs on each box that you can tune. And then let's say, well, let's look at the ways that we can put these different boxes together and kind of see what comes out. In that case, you actually expect that it might learn something, you know, it might be able to learn some things quite effectively. For instance, it might very well be able to learn things like matrix inversion, particularly by one of these sneaky methods that Robin proposed in the last talk. I mean, I don't, again, for Shor's algorithm, the hard part of Shor's algorithm in terms of the computation is the continued fraction expansion. So I don't know. This, of course, is just a classical learning kind of thing, and I don't know if anybody's used a deep classical network to learn a continued fraction expansion. But if they have, then that would be evidence that you could get the thing to learn Shor's algorithm.
Last question.
Ed, there's one other aspect to how, you know, real biological neurons work that is maybe worth discussing, which is that they take a bunch of input and they don't do anything until that reaches a certain level, right? And then they fire. And that's, I guess, part of the original inspiration for the neural networks is that's kind of akin to how a transistor works. And my understanding, which is not very good, of these neural networks is that if you just try and do, like, linear relationships from one level to the next, the network doesn't do anything useful. And you have to have this sort of, this almost, you know, this thresholding. And that's kind of really, I mean, it reminds me at least of wave function collapse and measurement. But that's something that we're almost sort of giving up when we go over to the quantum version, is we don't want to do that because then you don't preserve your superpositions. And I just find that interesting.
Yeah, so that's a very good point. So neurons themselves are very highly dissipative things. And actually, when they implement these sigmoid functions of their inputs, and if you try to do this quantum mechanically with continuous variables, it's a highly non-reversible process. However, the situation is not as bad as that. Let me go to this slide right here. So you can effectively set up a thresholding function in an Ising model. I mean, these actually, for instance, an AND gate, right? An AND is a thresholding function. It says the energy only when this one is 1 and this one is 1 is the ground state energy of this last 1, 1. I leave it as an exercise for you and actually for other people here to show that actually I can have multiple input AND gates, which are a similarly thresholding function, but over N inputs. So it's important to remember that, so these Ising-like interactions, they may be simple, but they, at the logical level, they're capable of implementing nonlinearity. I mean, a linear neural network, which is a perceptron, and these things were invented by Minsky, as they pointed out, again, back in the 50s, they can't compute their way out of a paper bag. And which is why it's so amazing that it might be that a linear array of linear optical elements doing, you know, quantum learning via boson sampling might be able to do something like that. That's quite remarkable. But the situation is not as bad as you're portraying. You can indeed get thresholding functions for all these things. It can be done in a reversible fashion. The fact that you're doing things in the ground state helps you out. So.
Let's thank Seth.
Thank you.